All we're hearing on the news is Ukraine. But yet here in America, what real Americans care about is gas prices they can't afford, inflation that goes up and up to where grocery bills are unaffordable, and they're very concerned about our out-of-control open border. Crime is out of control, but yet Washington is completely disconnected and seems to care more about sending our sons and daughters to a potential war where they do not belong. So I would like to urge my colleagues here in Congress, instead of working on a future COVID bill, spending billions of dollars on COVID that doesn't exist, let's care about our border and let's care about working to have energy independence to lower gas prices for Americans. Thank you.
So Marjorie Greene is free to be frustrated with the fact that one story is dominating the headlines. I frequently am. And if you believe that Congress should be able to walk and chew gum, that is perfectly fine. But again, she is not saying, let's help the people of Ukraine, let's take this seriously, and at the same time also address issues like inflation and gas prices. She is saying, let's turn now from this. I don't want to do anything for Ukraine. I don't want to help them. Let's turn to something else. And she is dead wrong about a lot of things there. Let's not gloss over the COVID doesn't exist comment she threw in at the end. But she is very much wrong about what the American people think. Is the situation in Ukraine the absolute most important issue to every American? Of course not, obviously. But they very much do not like what they're seeing. And she gets that her position is not shared by the vast majority of the American people, thus the desperation to get it out of the headlines. She doesn't, it is news, a news battleground that she does not feel fit to fight on because her values aren't shared by the American people. But anyway, like she put forward a bill to ban US funding of bioweapons in Ukraine. There have been a lot on the right that have jumped into this conspiracy theory about biolabs. She is now, I guess, the most out front on it because she's just declaring that we have been doing bioweapons and we should stop. You also have 8 Republicans who just yesterday voted against changing the trade relationship between the US and Russia. And again, I don't even have a super strong position on that exact change, but those names very much do. You see them voting in lockstep with each other on all of these positions. So this is not just a thing where their advocacy in comments and on social media has turned against Ukraine and is advancing Russian talking points about why the invasion was justified, to the ability that they have in elected office to get things done or to try to be obstacles to progress. They are very much doing that, and they have formed a small but potentially growing bloc to do that, Brett.
It's an epic flail. It's not just an epic fail, it's an epic flail. You mentioned this earlier in the show today, but bear in mind that in the wake of the invasion of Ukraine, the Republicans had nothing to say. They had no idea what to do or how to characterize this. And that was this is the residue of that instinct to just talk about anything else. In the meantime, it took Tucker Carlson, the smartest person in the stupid room of right-wing media, it took him 3 weeks to come up with this weak-ass garbage. Yeah. It took him 3 weeks, and you can see it. He's like, I wasn't rooting for Putin. Yes, you were. Like, you were. It took this long, and he's tried 5 different messages along the way. And so this is exactly the gobbledygook, because along the way, when Marjorie Taylor Greene was pitching this bioweapons thing, the language in her presentation of it was like, well, I don't know if it's happening, but if it's happening, we should make it illegal and we shouldn't be there. And they're going to send your kids to war. That's not the position of the left. That's not the position of the Biden White House. It's like, we're doing everything. We're not engaging in a no-fly zone. We're doing sanctions so that we don't go to war.
Can I jump in for 1 sec?
Go for it.
Because you're 100% right, and then we'll return to you. There are some people who seem to be either hinting at the possibility of direct involvement. I would count some White House press reporters who do that. In terms of people who are openly calling for it, there are a few, way less than in like any past conflict in my time covering the news. But there are a few. You had John Kennedy. You have people like Sean Hannity. You have people like they exist. They're Republicans. Like they're. Who on the left, AOC, Ilhan Omar, are they saying let's start sending Abrams tanks over the border? Nobody's saying that. If she has an issue with people advocating for our soldiers to go abroad, you got all those people on speed dial. You caucus with them. Why don't you go talk to your own side about the warmongering, Marjorie Greene?
Yep.
Continue, sorry.
No, that's it. The entire right wing echo chamber and, you know, ecosphere is just like a 9 year old babysitter of a 2 year old, and they're playing peekaboo. It doesn't, as long as they go like, then the kids are like, it's perfect. I love it. I don't know what's happening, but this seems to work. Combine that with like an underdeveloped sense of the world and no object permanence. Everything feels new to them. Everything feels entertaining to them. As long as they can cater to these base instincts that they have, they're fine. They're happy.
Yeah, I agree. But the epic flail is just a great description of it. You want an example in real time of an epic flail? More than two dozen Senate Republicans demand Biden do more for Ukraine after voting against the $13.6 billion for Ukraine. And again, you don't have to support every specific, but when you keep saying he's got to do more, but you don't like the sanctions, he's got to do more, you don't like banning the fuel, he's got to do more, you don't like when he changes the trade relationships, he's got to do more, but you don't like when he sends the weapons. What do you want him to do? Do you have a single actual idea bouncing around inside of your dome? If you do, feel free to let us know what it is.
It's every note session I've had with a crappy producer. Not apologies this, don't those. Do this, don't do this, but something like this, but not that, don't do that. There's a great Mitchell and Webb sketch you should watch called Not This. Exactly. It's exactly that. It's just like, well, then what do I want? What you want me to do is like, oh no, if I put my actual suggestions into effect and those happen, I might be held responsible for their success or failure. So I'm not.
Yeah.
I just need to criticize you. And Noam Chomsky even said that that is how the right wing has become a cult and basically shuffled off the spectrum and just become against democracy. So if you want a smart person saying those things, there's one.
Yeah. And look, I will close by saying we've criticized the fact that they don't know what they actually believe. They don't know, they're largely valueless, but how it applies to any of this. I think that we have been fairly clear. I do not want the US to get involved in a shooting war with a nuclear power. I don't want this to get any bigger than it needs to. I do believe that the Ukrainian people want to and deserve to defend their territory, and they deserve to have the best chance at succeeding against this absolutely barbaric invasion, both because that is their right as a sovereign country, but also because a vigorous defense, I believe, as a non-expert, is the best way to get us towards Putin being willing to withdraw, to forcing a diplomatic settlement. That is the best way to do that. And all of this is designed at every step, both on the ground right now and looking forward, to minimize loss of life. Ukrainian, anything wider, I don't want this war to become a worldwide thing. I don't want Russian soldiers to be dying. All of this should be working towards minimizing that. And I believe the path we're on is the best way to do that.
Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want, with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.